So today I'm headed to St. Louis for Iyanla Fix My Life. Just left my house, my home, in Ocean City, Maryland, and I have about a 2.5 to 3 hour drive, depending upon traffic, to the airport. So that's where I'm headed now. This story that we're doing in St. Louis is about workplace dysfunction fueled by family secrets. How does that sound? Workplace dysfunction fueled by family secrets. So that's what we're diving into in St. Louis. It's a rainy day here at the beach, and I'm going to settle into this drive and just enjoy myself. I love driving. And I'm an early riser anyway, so I'm always up. It's about 8:24 in the morning. I'm up, ready to roll for another day, for another adventure. I love going on trips, and I love coming home from trips. So the going energy is always anticipation. It's like when you were a child and you were going a road trip, and you would always say to your parents from the back seat, at least my sister and I did, "Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet?" That's anticipation. That's going anticipation, because you never know what you're going to meet in your process, in the process of air travel, in the process of ground transporting to wherever you have to be, the energy of the people along the way. It's all part of the travel experience. These days, I'm not a huge traveler. I really prefer to be at home most of the time, in my own space, doing my own thing. Working on this series requires travel, so I'm gone like maybe 2 or 3 months at a time. 2 or 3 months out of one part of the year, and then we stop down for a couple of months, and then we pick it back up 2 or 3 months for the later part of the year, and then we're done all our episodes. So I have like 2 to 3 months in between shooting. So I'm gone 1 week, gone the next week, gone the next week, gone the next week, gone the next week for like 8 weeks, then 2 months off, then another 8 week stint, and then we're done for the year. So prior to doing this series, I was at home where I like to be, at home, just chilling and doing my thing. I'm the kind of dude where I have everything. I'm a tourist. I have everything I want and need in my house, and I don't go anywhere. I do my work, I cook my food, I live my life, and I work in such a way and work to be on such a vibration that I attract everything that I want into my life, into where I am at home. So that means that I work from home and I attract the money back into me. I put the magnetism out, put the energy out, and then I attract the income back to me, and I don't really have to go a lot of places. So I worked very long and very hard to get to a place in my life where I didn't have to go into a corporate office every day, and I am glad to tell you that at this point in my life, I have arrived. I can work from home, and I love it. It's not for everybody. It requires a great amount of discipline to do it, but I have that discipline, and I enjoy that lifestyle. So for me, it's just great. What's going through my head today? What's in my soul space today? I brought moonstones with me on this trip. I bring crystals on every trip. People know that I do that. I bring crystals on every trip. And this trip, I brought moonstones. I love moonstones. They're very peaceful and relaxing energy about them. And I use them in my meditation, and I usually just line them up down my chakra meridian when I'm meditating. And it's just a great meditation with moonstones. So I have 9 moonstones that I brought with me, as well as I have about 4 pieces of moldavite that I always have with me when I travel. Moldavite is one of the oldest, if not the oldest, crystals around.
15 miles, keep right.
Moldavite is tektite, and it's a meteorite that struck the earth millions and millions of years ago. Some people say up to 15 million years ago. And you usually can only find it in the Czech Republic, in Moldavia, which is where it gets its name from, Moldavite. So it's pretty rare and a little costly, a little pricey, but it's worth it. And I try to get as much of it as I possibly can and keep as much of it around as I possibly can, so I have moldavite with me too. So those are the crystals that I brought on this trip. Because I'm flying, I don't have any food with me and I don't have any juice with me on this trip. So the search is always to eat well while I'm on the road. Last week in Chicago, there was a Whole Foods right in the bottom of the right in the bottom of the apartment complex where I was staying. So that was fantastic because I could just eat right at Whole Foods. And I had the most wonderful gorgonzola and mushroom pizza. I'm still thinking about that gorgonzola and mushroom pizza. I even went home and tried to make it myself. That's how much I enjoyed it. I did pretty good, but I needed to add more cheese. And I got to work with my crust, which I also made myself. So the search is always on for good eating on the road. And my eating mantra these days is light but well. Eating light but well. So I'll be on the hunt in St. Louis for some light but well eating. That's all I got for you right now. I'm going to settle into this drive and I'll show you as much of the journey as I can. Just reflecting on some of the choices that I've made in the past with my health and some of the things that I used to do that I wouldn't think of doing now. I would dream it and maybe contemplate it, but the amount of smoke that I've put in my body from smoking, I just wouldn't even think to do that now. And then when I see people who smoke now, I began running an internal dialogue about asking myself about the pain that they must be in, or the trauma, or what the challenges are that lead them to smoking. I'm just conscious of it in a way now that I never really was before, particularly when I was indulging myself. But it's funny how life is like that you can be fully present in and with your dysfunction at one point in your life and be completely immune and above it at another point in your life. And that really is the awakening. That's the awakening process. Awakening to your pain, awakening to your challenges, awakening to your dysfunction, awakening from an unconscious state where you unconsciously created your life and created the things in your life. So I was just driving and reflecting on how health and wellness for me has been and is a process. It's a process of coming out of that self-destruction and self-hatred and really choosing with my thoughts moment to moment to live, and to live well in a healthy body, whole and intact, free from all dis-ease on every level. That's a choice. And it's not a choice you make once. It's a choice you make over and over and over again, particularly with the food that you eat and the exercise that you partake in on a daily basis. Three things that I know that I need to do and to be in order to survive in the 21st century. The first, master my daily diet. The second, master my daily exercise. And the third, master higher spiritual consciousness. That's my survival kit for the 21st century. And I'm taping this in February of this year, 2014. And I'm doing pretty good. I'm doing pretty good with my eating. So far this year, I have not had any flesh at all. I've been eating mostly plant food, and I feel great. So I'm really happy about that. My goal was to not eat any flesh this year, And so far, it's only like 6 weeks into it, 7 weeks into it, but so far I haven't had it. So I feel good about that. And that's what I mean when I say it's a process. It's just taking it one step, one choice, one decision at a time, really. And trying to make the healthiest choice that I can make in the moment, given wherever my emotions are at that particular time. So regarding the flesh, I'm doing pretty good. I'm doing pretty good. So I'm here at the hotel in St. Louis. Safe travels all the way from Washington to St. Louis. And I was sitting at the airport at BWI before taking off, and I got a message from the executive producer saying that one of our two main guests, if you will, bailed on us. And that means that at the last minute, she decided that this was not something that she wanted to participate in. So we had two main characters in this story. They are sisters, and one of the sisters decided that she did not want to participate. She made this decision when the team is on the ground in town. So we have to figure out what we're going to do. And we don't really know yet how we're going to proceed, how we're going to shift the story to reflect the fact that she will not be participating. It's a tricky situation for a producer to be in. It's also a creative challenge. And human beings were made for creative challenges. That's what got us this far as a species. So we will huddle at some point this evening and figure out how we're going to proceed. We are going to proceed. The question becomes, how are we going to proceed?
At some points, sure, it absolutely is, but you're going to have to go through that in order to get to, you know, the right healing place. And so that has been the conversation. I talked to her in L.A. She was on her way into the W for whatever party. She wasn't really focused, but I was, you know, giving her, she said, okay, and seemed like she was fine. The next morning, that night, actually, I was on the plane. So then the next morning, which was yesterday morning, T called me from L.A. before she got on the plane and said, oh, I got the same thing, brand. She just has all this fear about my brand.
Well, how does shopping and not handling your business advance your brand? How does not speaking to your sister advance your brand?
But nobody knows about that.
But she knows about it.
She does, but the world doesn't know about that.
And her, and so...
Oh, so it's other people knowing.
It's going public with your stuff.
Right, exactly.
When you have a business that is built upon quality, service, friendliness, da-da-da-da, I mean, that's major.
Was that the agreement?
I don't know if that's the agreement.
Was that the understanding? I guess not, because if it were, the people wouldn't be complaining about it.
Right.
You know, I first of all want to acknowledge you for taking this step, knowing that it could be an example for many.
Right.
But also, we really got to get in here and clean this up. Otherwise, you will open up this door and expose yourself. And if you don't shift, change, and get the healing, it's going to be worse than it was.
Let's remember what you said, where were you, and you said as an attorney, you open up by stating your worst fear?
That's right. No, you stated, yes, my client beat that old woman in her head and raped her dog and stole all the china from the old man next door, but that don't have nothing to do with why we're here today.
Right. So that's the approach then.
Yeah.
Put all her worst fears right up there in the front.
Yeah, that's good. She needs that.
Take the teeth out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And also talk about the resistance. But we're starting at the business, right?
To take a little deeper dive into this situation, because this happens when you're making television, particularly this kind of show, it doesn't happen often that we're there in the city and someone says that they don't want to participate. But people do take a second look at this process. Because what we're asking of you is to open up your soul and share your stuff. And this is stuff that has been painful for you most of the time for years and years and years and years. And so when you take this journey with Iyanla, you are taking a deep dive into your soul. And not everybody is willing to do that. There's one thing. It's one thing to answer some questions about your situation, to make a video about your situation and send it in for submission. That's one thing. It's another thing when we knock on your door and start putting up lights, positioning cameras, and prepping you for what is really going to happen in 24 hours when Iyanla shows up. That's a different ball game. And sometimes the weight of that and the reality of that sets in on a person's heart and soul, and they begin to think about the impact of taking that deep dive with Iyanla, and they decide that this is something that they don't want to do. And frankly, I don't blame them. It constantly boggles my mind after 20 years in television why people want to go on TV and share all of this stuff about themselves. But then again, people say to me, why do you tell all your business on your radio show? Why do you share all of that? So I get it. I get it. It's a release from your soul. It's liberation. Truth, your truth, will set you free. Now, it may hurt like hell first, but eventually, the truth will set you free. So this is a woman who had second thoughts about sharing her truth on television. So we'll huddle and see how we're going to proceed in the wake of that reality. It's a good challenge. Was Miss Robbie at Sweetie Pies?
No.
She wasn't there. Was Tim there?
No, he's in Philadelphia.
Okay.
I didn't ask him.
Okay. Was the food good?
Yes.
Really?
Okay.
The chicken is the way, I don't know what they do to that damn chicken.
What kind of chicken?
Fried chicken wings. Is there any other thing to have?
Right, exactly.
And I had the cabbage, which was, they use a lot of sugar
okay.
in their food.
You feel sleepy?
The cabbage had sugar in
it. Right. Is it far? Is it far from here?
15 minutes. You take that I-70 east and get off at...
But it's 8 o'clock. You don't need to be eating no fried chicken at 8 o'clock at night.
You're right. I know. I'm not
doing that. Go tomorrow after.
Mm-hmm.
And I had the mac and cheese, which is pure just heart attack on a plate.
Mm-hmm. That's so good, right?
And they had okra. I don't eat okra. They had corn. Rodney had mashed potatoes and gravy. That was good. They didn't have any yams today, any greens today. They had green beans and Salisbury steak. Tomorrow's Wednesday, they have duck. Mm-hmm. I don't know what they're going to do with the duck.
Fried.
Listen, I got Latin in me. We fry everything.
Sure.
You can fry anything. You hungry, get that shoe over there. Dummy. Dummy.
We're going to make it taste good.
Mm-hmm. Buto frio. Well, okay. I'm glad we're back on track. I was like...
So how did you get her back? Like, what was that conversation?
Well, I'm going to tell you, I didn't talk to her this morning, and my approach was that she thought she was going to shut the whole thing down. But then it was like, I should have makeup, and I should have da-da-da if I'm going to do this anyway, and just all this diva stuff, like... She wanted to be catered to, stroked, all that stuff. And I was like, we're not going to do that. We're not going to do all that. Well, yeah, she said that, she would do it if she could just, she just needs to feel pretty. That's it. Okay, so she went from I'm not doing it this morning to now she'll do it. What does she need? Well, I think she just wants some makeup.
Did she have makeup at the W over the weekend?
And so then I said, so she just needs some makeup. I said, well, let me talk to her. So then they called her, put her on the phone. And so I said, okay, so let me just get, I just want to be clear, because, you know, we've been back and forth. So you're open to do this if we have someone who can do something to your face and make you feel pretty. Well, I'm actually a really pretty girl. I didn't say make you feel pretty. I said, you know, to do your makeup. And she goes, I'm actually a really pretty girl. So I don't even really need a lot of makeup.
Her conversation. Do you remember her conversation, Robert? But I had notes all.
Yeah, I know you do your scribbles and stuff on your paper, so. Image is key. When you're making money, and she's made some money, and her character has evolved in that direction, and so this could crumble a lot
yeah,
of that.
Well, yeah, but image is key, but it has to be an image that's in integrity.
Right.
And an image that's in alignment. I don't think any of this has anything to do with her capacity or ability to provide service to her constituency.
Hey, Valencia,
the question becomes, or what is the foundation that you're building
exactly,
the business on?
Exactly.
And what is more important
okay.
to you?
Exactly.
The image or the integrity?
That's right.
You know, is it about the what people think, or is it about what you know
that's right.
and what's really going on? And I need to, that's what I want to get clear. I want to get clear with you, what is more important to you? Is it your image or your integrity? Because image can only take you so far, you know. But integrity, you can use that to build
yeah.
and
not,
to
not
grow
anymore.
And to expand. So I need
okay.
to understand that.
And the truth is what you always say.
8:12.
You wouldn't be here if everything was okay.
That's right.
So something
Somebody
has gone off course.
Right.
Exactly.
I could have stayed home.
Exactly.
I didn't have to come here.
Right.
So it's about integrity. And that's what everything is missing. And I think that's the note that I have on my paperwork, that this is about integrity and foundation, and there were some other principles that I had written on there.
I'm going to give you my packet, okay? And then Valencia.
I
know.
I think they did.
Yeah. Kimberly, I brought you something.
What'd you bring me?
A moonstone.
I love moonstones.
You love moonstones?
Yes.
You know about that?
Yes.
Oh, goody,
that
goody, goody.
Kind of opalescence. Got a little.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. That's awfully sweet.
You know, I think
okay,
about
so tell
you.
Me what moonstones are good for.
Well, you know, all stones work with your energy. But
okay.
for me, it's a very peaceful, calming stone. Sometimes when I lie on my bed,
mm-hmm.
just put it right here.
Okay, right. In
just right on your
if
third
eye. If I get any more
yeah.
peaceful, though.
You're going to fall asleep, right? You're
exactly.
going to float away.
Exactly. Exactly. Ooh, I thank you for that.
You're welcome.
That's awfully kind of you. Awfully kind. And you know what? I don't have any moonstones.
You don't?
Mm-mm.
You got some now.
Moonstones are good for dreams, too, and clairvoyance.
Really?
They are?
Okay. I will be carrying you then.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm going to send you this footage so you can have it in your archives. Because I got a lot of you, yeah.
Do you?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Got a lot.
Oh, I'd love to have it.
Mm-hmm. I'll email it to you.
Okay.
I think I have your email address.
You do. And I got your invite on LinkedIn.
You did?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you use it?
You know what? I just started using it.
Okay.
I just started using it.
No, but who is taking pictures this season?
Chella is the PA. So whoever the PA for the team is, Jay-Z did when we were in
mm-hmm.
Suffern.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see who was on it. Last week Chella did because she was on the shoot.
Mm-hmm.
So today I'm not sure who will have it. And then they give the camera back to Naomi and she takes it back to Chicago.
How was your flight coming in?
Groovy, groovy. Every flight I give off of is a good flight.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
You came, you had to make a connection.
No, I got a straight flight.
From BWI?
Mm-hmm.
We didn't see that on the board.
Mm-hmm.
Rodney.
Yes, ma'am.
What is
Are you camera shy?
The,
okay.
Where is the skirt from? Lafayette.
Kim has it. Not Kim.
Michelle.
Michelle has it. She's shipping it to us.
Okay.
You want to see a picture of it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So when you left for this trip, you got multiple events that you have to go to.
I have 12 events I got to go to.
Oof. You got it all in that little red suitcase?
No, I shipped some of the stuff ahead of me.
Right, okay, nice. All right. So let's talk about your events. What are you going to? What are you excited about?
Well, we're doing a show here in, where am I?
You're in St. Louis.
St. Louis. And then we're going to California for the NAACP Image Awards.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Two events there. Then I have a photo shoot for Bill Duke's book, Dark Girl.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
And then I'm going to back to Chicago to do two life classes. Then I'm going to Suffern, New York to do another show.
Socrates.
And then I'm going back to L.A. for the Essence Black Women in Hollywood luncheon.
Oh, that's your thing. Yeah, that was where you rocked the red with CC Pounder, CCH last year. Uh-huh. Yeah. Very nice, very nice. Let's talk about the Image Award. What are your thoughts about that?
I'm honored and grateful that we were nominated because it just says that people are willing to see the kind of television that we do or they're noticing it. I'm not attached to winning or not winning. Just to have the shows, to have our name called among the people in our category, you know,
right.
The Shark Tank,
right.
Come on, and which is a network show, The Voice, mm-hmm. which is a network show, Sunday Best, which is you know a huge show in our demographic. So, just to be called in that category, I think it's a good thing.
Right. One of the things about the Image Awards is that. And it doesn't mean something to some people, but it is a unique honor to be chosen by your peers in our community.
Right.
And so that's special.
Well, that they noticed the show, you know, over on OWN, the network that everybody thought was going to fall apart, that they even noticed it, I think is good. Because Sweetie Pies is also in our category.
Right.
So that's good.
Yeah, it is.
He's in After Midnight, Dulé Hill. Isn't that the show that
fans right now in the Winter Olympics?
I don't watch that.
And
you can't appreciate curling?
Well, no. No, I
they
cannot.
Said, they said that black people curling is mopping.
Mopping, right. Right, okay, right.
They had a picture.
Exactly. Ain't that
and
the
what
truth?
Was that? It was another mopping. Useless sport they had. And then, I can't remember.
And thus, you don't see too many black people participating in curling.
No, you see all Olympic. Black people participating in curling. We just can't get a prize for it.
Right, okay.
Every company, corporation has some black person mopping somewhere.
Ooh, let me cut the video off of this
one.
Because daddy's up and down, tipping down, so in the bottle. I got that. I can play that right
gorgeous,
now.
Don't
fussy.
You think it's a crime?
Time after time, digging in the bottle. Yeah. That's right.
But you know, it's amazing that some of these genius performers, they sing their healing.
Yeah.
Just like DMX.
Mm-hmm.
Sings his healing.
Mm-hmm.
And then don't do it.
Right.
Yeah. But on that documentary, one of his contributors said that the lyrics to one of his songs, he was singing about himself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in deep pain.
For many people, the polarity of greatness mm-hmm. is darkness.
Yeah, well, that's
it. And it's just one of those things.
I ain't going there.
You ain't going there?
I'm so glad that I got my brain together before I found any level of success in my life.
Yeah. I'm gonna do makeup, y'all. Joking. Almost done.
Let's see if I got Lafayette. Yeah, that's black and white. The Lafayette is
black and white, right? Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You look beautiful. Okay, I'm sorry. You are beautiful. My mistake.
Mm-hmm.
My mistake.
You are so beautiful.
I love that song.
Joe Cocker, right?
Joe Cocker.
Mm-hmm.
To me.
I taught that to my dance students. Had this little girl.
Mm.
She was so sweet and tiny. Mm-hmm. And she walks out across the stage, clunk, 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 clunk. Mm-hmm. Sits down on the chair. She put her, tapped her ballet shoes on. Over that song.
Mm-hmm.
And then by the time he got to, "You're everything I hope for," she just got up and started dancing and danced her way off the stage.
Precious.
I got it.
You got a spirit in here. No, it's audio.
It's audio.
It's audio.
Yeah, it's by the white audio. Thank you.
I just want you to know, I don't usually take
my rig is outside by where we did the circle up.
You know, I just ripped my jacket off, pulled my thing down for him.
That's how I see it all the time.
My rig is outside. The rig that's
and you
inside
do it in an
is the
RV.
D-rig.
Right.
Is it in your way?
Here's the driver.
Oh, no, it's already
been maximizing everybody. Kim's driving.
Is the car set up already?
Yes.
Good day, and I didn't want to fool
up enough about the car.
For the bird. Sorry.
And a 13 on.
I think you are doing too much pickling on my face.
I am. I'm just putting a little bit of mattifier on you.
Mattifier.
Just a little mattifier.
Just me up for that darn Vaseline.
I'm good, but I'm going to run back with another little piece of tape.
Just a little.
What are you doing with it?
This is it. This is
a photo album, aren't you?
Yeah, man, when I'm 80, I'll appreciate all of that, you know?
There you go. You might not need the Vaseline today. You got channel long.
You're good.
Beautiful. Does it feel dry? Do you want a little more moisture on top?
Yes.
And then I'm going to step away. You won't see me till lunchtime. You said you lie.
She's having a break.
This lipstick color is beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Prescriptions used to
really
have
pretty.
One called cinnamon.
Mm-hmm.
That was very much like this.
Yeah.
And they discontinued it. So
if y'all ever need any of my footage, you're welcome. Just let me know.
Okay. I would love to have some.
You know, I got a lot of stuff.
A lot of stuff, right?
But see, Eric can put it up on YouTube.
Yeah, I got it. That's why I put it on my YouTube channel.
So why don't you send it to
I can send it to him. Yeah.
I think you and Siobhan are like,
I get it all.
I know.
So she's looking at
Siobhan.
Because when I'm 80, I'll appreciate the life that I live, you know?
I call her Eagle Eye Speaker. Because she see everything and she know everything. Siobhan videotapes her food before she eats it in the
restaurant.
Yes!
She was particularly lovely last week in Chicago. Bring a to the car, guys.
That's a problem. I need to ask her about that.
Although we're not ready to go yet.
That's not the point. What time is she supposed to be? So if you go ready,
she told the guest to get here earlier than she should.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, what time did she do? What time is she?
Given yesterday, you just want to establish authority right at the break. That's what
I have to do. And I would do that for anybody.
Right.
I would do that for anybody.
Yep.
That's DMX, somebody else. Tim.
Oh, right.
Okay, God, what am I teaching today? What am I teaching? And the message I got was, you're not teaching today, you're learning. Isn't that good? So we're learning today. Does everybody in this circle have a sister?
A sister?
A sister.
Sister, yes.
No? Is that brothers?
Both. Yes, both.
Your only child? So we are here to learn today. I'm sure there'll be some exciting something for us to learn. So pay very close attention, as I will be doing today. I always am grateful that we have this opportunity to serve and healing work. That's a good thing always. Thank you for your service. So I have to listen very deeply today. So if I'm in an altered state of consciousness, and you can't, then you say something to me and I don't
listening and learning. Okay? Good. So we're going to fix a life.
Stretch.
Yes.
I'm going to wait till we get out of here to lift up the camera so you can see. This is a busy highway.
Busy.
Safety first. Robert, are you okay?
I'm good, man. Okay. It's all good. Thank you for asking.
We have the heat off this time.
Right. I just don't understand why.
Help me understand.
Help me understand. This is reality, right?
We're allowed to understand.
Exactly.
And if somebody were to call and say, we couldn't hear her because the heat was on, I think you need to turn your channel.
I mean, it's winter, right? Wouldn't people expect to hear heat in winter? Yes, these things are true.
I got no words.
No words.
This is a busy little thoroughfare.
Yeah, sure.
I know. Why aren't these people at home or work or somewhere?
And I walked inside the store looking for the cooler. I recognized that the owners, the proprietors of the store, were not people of color.
Okay.
And I said, there's no way I'm going to buy a collard green from Asia. I'm just not going to do it. Not in Georgia. When my ancestors picked greens and couldn't eat not in Georgia. Where we picked cotton and whipped slave and were whipped and beaten as slaves. Not in our neighborhood. I'm gonna buy some collard greens from Asia.
Yeah, your ancestors would roll over in their grave.
I don't even know how they got a score in our neighborhood. And that bothered me more than the fact that the Asians
not be putting that.
Somebody.
Nobody.
Something in here. Somebody.
An experience.
I said, what
that
was
opened up your DNA codes.
What? And
being
in the which is why I didn't go to college until I was 30. I didn't even know it was a possibility for me. Because in my generation, it was finish high school, get a good job, get married. Mm-hmm. And find you a man that can take care of you. Mm-hmm. That was not working. I got plenty of good jobs, and I wanted to be a nurse. At that time, nursing schools were attached to hospitals. I got accepted to two nursing schools, but then I got pregnant with him. I got accepted to two nursing schools and had a four-year scholarship for dance to USC.
What?
Dance.
Okay, so
Could not. Nobody would buy me a plane ticket to go to California. So I said, okay, that's okay.
This is like in the 40s, though, you know.
Shut this up. Ain't the 40s.
Did you see how quick she
came? Okay, but now given what you just said about wanting to be a nurse and all that, at what point did you have the consciousness that you would be or wanted to become who you are today? Like, when did that kick in?
Let me tell you, this is how it happened, and I wrote about this in TAP, and I say this all the time. I had no conscious awareness of what I wanted to be. I just knew what I was no longer willing to be.
I received that.
I was no longer willing to be that. So I'm on the bus coming from the welfare office, and the sign says, are you ready to make your life different? Come to Medgar's College. I said, that's it, I'm going. I got off the bus that day. I got off the bus that day. Got on the Nostrand Avenue bus in Brooklyn and went to Mega Evans College, where I met the admissions officer, Linda DeJesus, who's my friend to this very day. And she says, well, what do you want to study? I said, I don't know. What can I study? She showed me this. I said, public administration, what does that mean? So she said, you know, government agencies. I had been programmed, get you a good government job.
Exactly.
Fine, I'll do public administration.
When did you meet Betty Shabazz?
At Medgar's College.
Okay, so let's fast forward a little bit more, because this goes back to the vision that you were talking to these women about.
Right.
At some point, you said, I can write a book, I can empower people. Like, at what point did you... So all of this happened unconsciously, is what you're saying.
And here's the piece. You live life consciously, unconsciously, or by default. Consciously, you're saying, this is where I'm going, this is how I'm going to get there, this is what's going to happen when I get there.
Unconsciously, you'll say, well, I'll go there. Let me see what happens. Let me see what shows up. Default is, oh my God, this is what's going on. Let me pay attention to that. Let me do this. I was living unconsciously. Mm-hmm. And still, my purpose and mission were unfolding. Because had I never went to Mega Evers and been involved in the student takeover, became a student government president, and I would have never learned the principles of leadership from an African perspective. Mm-hmm. Had I not gone to Mega Evers and so many of the professors there who taught me leadership from an African perspective said to me, you should be a lawyer, I would have never went to law school.
Mm-hmm. I'm not asking you the right question.
Okay.
That's the problem. At what point did you first get the idea that I can write a book? That I have something to say.
I was teaching women in not ACORN. It was a program designed to prepare women who were coming off welfare to go back to work. And a friend of mine worked there. When I stopped practicing law, my unemployment was running out. She said, come teach these women life skills. So I would teach them life skills, and every day I would make handouts for them. You gotta do this, you gotta do that. But I had learned leadership from an African perspective. Mm-hmm. And I have an African-grounded foundation in spirituality. So I'm combining that plus the laws and the thing. Always been a Bible student. And I'm putting these things together as handouts. So after I had been teaching there for 2 years, I had this whole pile of handouts. Mm-hmm. And my friend said to me, that's a book.
Exactly.
You need to make that
that's
into a book.
That's what I want to hear.
How do you do that?
Right.
Go to Kinko's. So I went to Kinko's.
That's what I'm saying. Exactly.
I had a computer with no printer. Mm-hmm. So I used to print it up, and I went to Kinko's, and I met Robin. Robin worked in Kinko's, and she was a typist. And so I would take my disc to Robin in Kinko's, and she would line it up for me and set it up and print it. That's how Tapping the Power Within came
about. I love that you remember that.
Robin, yes, details, I remember exactly. It was Robin. What? She typed for me for years because I had a computer but no printer.
Okay.
So that book was hugely successful for you.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then did you say, this is what I can, this is what I want?
No. Tapping the Power Within, I was selling it out the trunk of my car. And putting it on consignment in black bookstores. So in Philadelphia, the Deke and his brother, I can't even remember his brother's name, Deke and, oh my God, what was his brother's name? They're both dead now. And brother Hakeem on 52nd Street, they told Haki in Chicago. And they told brother Jordan in New York. So Haki called me. They tell me, you got a nice book. Can you send me some copies on consignment?
Beautiful.
You
know what I'm saying?
And I was sending them to New York and Black Minds Books in New York. And, oh, my God, the Tree of Life in New York. I'm sending them 10 copies, 12 copies that I have printed at Kinko's.
I love it. I love it.
Typing
them up.
Right? You know, well, it was tight then. And then when I wanted to get it really printed, Seter Arnouf, who was a brother in the Sarset Society in Philadelphia. My brother, Siddiqui, created the artwork, and Seter Arnouf lent me the money to send it off to be printed. And I printed 1,500 copies of Tapping the Power Within. He paid for it and did the book signing in his vegetarian restaurant in Germantown.
God bless him. God bless. That is a YouTube.
That is.
Okay.
And living by default. When you see all of these young black boys, you know, I just came from Chicago, July 4th, 50 people were murdered, you know, gang violence. They're obviously living, I guess, by default, unconsciously, but how
they're living,
are they
consciously
not waking up, though?
They're living consciously. These young kids, I believe, who are killing each other and living in the streets and living by violence, they're living consciously from a low level of consciousness.
Yes, vibration, that's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Consciously means this is what I'm doing, this
intention
is how I'm doing
it.
This, you got some intention. Consciousness is the sum total of all of your thoughts, beliefs, programs, conditions, learnings, everything. That's consciousness.
That's right.
So they come from a very low vibration, vibratory consciousness that says, get what you can, don't trust nobody, everybody's out for you, get the money, you know, F you, up yours, but so that's the level of consciousness which breeds this level of violence and hostility and separation. Because the only way you can attack somebody is if you believe that you are being attacked.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And therefore must defend yourself first and take no responsibility for your attack because you believe they were coming for you. And that's how our young people live. They live in this consciousness that either I'm a do or I'm a be done. Saigon said it to us.
Yeah.
He said, when you go to prison, you either be the victim or victim or the victimized. You
either be victim.
Oh wait, the victimizer
or the victim.
Victim.
Yeah. You know what? It's a mental conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
It's a mental conditioning that result in a defensive kind of behavior. Hmm. The only way that you can go after somebody is if you really believe that who they are has no impact on you.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we are, no impact on you.
Okay, because that brings me to a couple of things, the Jordan Davis situation and Trayvon Martin. But also, what's the solution? Like, what, you know, we talk
separation,
a lot about it.
Ultimate separation.
It is not. It is not. That's why we have the problem. Because we believe in separation.
But we're not separated.
Because we are separated in our consciousness.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because I believe that I can cuss you, sleep with your husband, crash your car, steal your money, cuss your mama.
Consequences.
That, yeah, I'm good.
That, right. And mm-hmm. and it doesn't have an impact on me that I don't recognize. That sleeping with your husband soils my soul.
Yeah, your pain.
That cussing your mama soils my soul.
Yeah.
And as long as we believe that we're separate and what you do to one another has no implications on you whatsoever, that is what the ego wants you to believe.
Right.
Preach it, y'all.
It don't have nothing to do with white folk.
That's right.
It has to do with the ego and the belief that your own personal ego has led you to believe that not only are you separate from God, but you're separate from everybody
But the thought of separation from God is something I was taught to the African by the slave master. Is that accurate?
Yeah, but you don't remember that.
I wasn't here, but my DNA remembers.
Yes.
That's how I'm able to say it.
But you know what? Even the slaves, they were separate from God, but they had another God. They didn't have the God of the slave masters
That's
in
right.
their mind.
That's right.
You understand? We all know there's one God.
Mm-hmm.
But the God that the slaves believed in is the one that would give them the strength
mm-hmm.
to pick cotton
mm-hmm.
from sun up to sundown
right.
and sell their babies off.
Mm-hmm.
That was a different God. That was not the slave master's
God. Why would
that
even let them be in that situation?
Well, it wasn't about God allowing them to be. All things are lessons
mm-hmm.
that God would have us learn.
Mm-hmm.
And were it not for slavery, the genius and the power and the glory of black folk would not have spread as wisely as it did. Now, something went on in the divine plan because we didn't come here just to be slaves and just to pick cotton and just to suffer.
Just to
something
entertain.
Else
right.
went on.
You think our genius is being spread over the world because of slavery?
I said it was spread. It was spread.
Africans weren't slaves in Egypt or Timbuktu.
Yeah, but we're not talking about that. We're talking about how the number of
Africans.
And see, the piece that you refuse to accept is the fact that we were complicit because we were told it's in the hieroglyphics on the pyramids. Turn the ships around. Turn the ships around. However, our physical senses and our ego disobedience.
And remember.
And the fact that some of us welcomed them onto the
shores.
That's
right. But you got to remember
and
why.
Sold them off.
Why?
That's
sold,
right.
And sold
that's
them
right.
off.
What about
well.
Why? Don't forget the why. The why is very important.
There is no why.
From the 6th century.
There is no why.
It is. 6th to the 13th century, Africans were fighting jihads against the Muslims. So by the time the Europeans got there in 1452, they were tired. They were beat. They were exhausted. They
you know what?
No
I was
war.
Tired and I was beaten. I was
so,
exhausted after I buried my daughter and God said, take your butt to California and do starting over. You got to be obedient. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Turn the ships around. Don't let them on. Don't entertain them. That's what we were told.
I agree with
and
you,
we did
that's,
it anyway.
That's what they was dealing with. So for them,
I don't care what they were dealing with. Like, be obedient.
Man, we can't turn these ships around.
Be obedient.
And there's a consequence for disobedience.
Amen. Amen.
And that's what we're living, sweetheart.
Exactly.
The consequence.
Yes, we are.
That disobedience.
Yes, we are.
From our own people.
Yes, we are.
We have to accept that.
We
and learn from it and move on.
And build from this
place.
And
the fact that we haven't learned from it, that we haven't accepted it, that we won't learn from it, and we blame. Listen, 99% of what you see is a function of what's going on in your own mind.
Yeah.
That's why I stopped.
There are no problems outside of yourself. There are no problems outside of yourself.
That's why I stopped seeing white folks as a problem. My mama is a problem. My daddy is a problem.
Exactly.
99% of what I see is a function of what goes on in my mind, because I am responsible for what
everything.
I see.
Exactly.
What I see.
Exactly.
And that's why when the Course says, I do not understand what anything is for. I do not perceive my own best interests. My mind is preoccupied with past thoughts. I see nothing as it is now.
Exactly.
Above all else, I am determined to see differently.
Can we get an offer plate here? She's coming with the
plate. And that's the truth that you just said.
We can't unify because we haven't healed. We haven't healed.
Separation.
Separation.
You gotta separate yourself from the miseducation. You have to.
From the miseducation.
Now that's true.
In a false religion, you gotta separate yourself from that first.
But that is
that. But not from the
mean. What you have to define exactly what you mean by separation and what way.
They teach us in America. When you go to school and they have us. A pledge allegiance to the flag of the people who killed you and murdered you. When you have loyalty to a country that has no loyalty to you. When you go and learn about Lincoln and George Washington and all those guys, Jefferson, knowing and not the truth about who they were, about the slaves they owned and the murders they committed against our forefathers. That's miseducation.
But you know what? I didn't know none of that.
And Jesus in the Bible.
I didn't know none of that.
All of that is a slave.
Yeah, but I didn't know none of that. I didn't know because I got educated in the same crazy public educational system. But I tell you what I did know how to do. I knew how to burn sage and pour water in a sweat lodge. I knew that. I knew how to pour water to my ancestors. I knew how to invoke my ancestors. And I was living a lie. But my connection to the culture and to the spirit is what led me in a whole nother direction.
And it led you, as you just told us. Because even when you get the education that Damon is talking about, and this is what a lot of those young brothers don't want to do. You still got to build brick.
By brick. Let me tell you something.
Brick,
and that's why I started working when I was 13 years old. When I think about it, it blows my mind that I have been working for 47 years. 47 years.
That's a lot of bricks.
You understand? And I started working after school, standing on my feet, running a cash register in the supermarket. So when I see them do that, today.
Right, that's easy.
That's funny to me.
Right.
You understand? Because I had to go $1.29.
Exactly,
yeah. $8.99, meat.
Exactly.
You understand? Right? And then when after I had him, and I had to, like I said, my mother wouldn't babysit for me. I had to get up, prepare his stuff, get it to the train station. I had enough sense to go to work in a daycare center so that I didn't have to pay for childcare. I made $100 a week. And out of that $100 came car fare to get back and forth to work, came Pampers so that he would have what he needed, came his food and stuff. It was not about buying no clothes. You understand? And if I could go to the movies for $2 or weave, right? If I could go to the movies for $2.50, 99% of the time I would opt for a slice of pizza and a good TV show because I was a mother. Uh-huh. So having three and four.
Bingo.
You understand?
And that's a luxury that we have as men that you don't have as a woman when you have a child.
No.
We can opt out.
Yeah.
All them brothers in jail who are brilliant, who have all this knowledge that you're talking about, they're not willing to build brick by brick. They're not going to do that. They want fast and easy cash.
The patience,
you know, building brick by brick
to build brick by brick. That time that it takes, you know,
right.
What's going on inside of someone during that time is
character.
An issue that
you build your character.
Is that triggering the cellular memory of picking the cotton?
You
when
know
you
what?
Go,
Again.
I can't do this. This is not.
Yes.
You know,
I think
I mean?
The one thing that I had that saved me from the dysfunction the conflama and the discord of my life was I had the spiritual foundation. Mm-hmm. Really, I really did.
And how was because, that seated? How did you get that? How
in
did you get that?
Reverend Knight's church.
Okay. It was always good. It was always
in the church.
But it was Reverend Knight's church combined with the one thing I grew up with was culture.
Mm-hmm.
I never ever. I mean, my hair looked like this when I was 9 years old.
Right. Okay. That's real.
And I knew African dance.
Right.
And I knew African garb, and I knew African cultural history, and I had an African spiritual philosophy, and my mother was a Native American. Right. I was running barefooted on the reservation when I was 4 and 6 years old, right. And I understood a full moon and a new moon and a waning moon and a waxing moon, how to go outside and dig something and bury it, exactly. How to lay your body at a tree, how to speak into the dirt.
Yes.
I knew these things as a child.
Right. You could control the weather
but
and everything.
But I couldn't speak them because we was going to Reverend Ike's church.
Right.
So
that was too pagan for him.
When I introduced Jesus to the sweat pipe, he was like, "Yo, that's cool." Right. I hear you, my sister. I can do the pipe with you. You understand?
When did you find the course? When did you come across?
1979.
That's the Course in Miracles.
Course in Miracles. Because I have a tendency to be rebellious. And I will go to the places that you would most be unlikely to find me.
Right.
So my mom read The Village Voice, mm-hmm. which was where all the freaky, weird, beatnik stuff was. Right, even still. So, you know, A Course in Miracles in The Village Voice. Like, damn. Wow, okay. I don't know what that is, but I'm going and you pull the ad out and you get the paper and then you go, and when they open the white folk open the door and see you, they can't be shocked because this is A Course in Miracles.
Right. Let me see this differently.
Above all else, I want to see things differently. And so you end up being the only black person in a circle of 6 white people that are studying this strange book in a apartment in the village.
Mm-hmm.
And you keep going. And eventually they get over their shock and horrification.
I think that's my favorite word, you say horrification.
Yeah, that's how I got everything. Whether it was TM or Kundalini Yoga or whatever, I'm like, in the Village Voice. Or the Gazette in Philly or wherever, you know, weird places. So and I will rebel. I am rebellious.
Mm-hmm. But you know what? It's like in each one of your rebellions, it made you who you are.
Yeah.
And there's no such thing as coincidences. Exactly.
Please tell me there's something I can't do. Please tell me there's something I can't do because I'm going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to do that. Yeah. I am. Mm-hmm. Now, as a child, rebellion and defiant got me beat and got me in a lot of trouble.
Right.
Just you like understand? Right? Rebellion and defiant. But now I use it consciously to rebel against limitations and limited perspective of reality and to defy expectations.
Right, that's right.
Because at 30 with 3 kids going to college at night, no one expected me to succeed.
That's right.
They didn't expect it.
Did anyone tell you verbally this isn't going to work?
Oh, yeah. Where you going? You're going to give up your check?
Right.
You're going to give up your check to go to college? You crazy.
Welfare check.
And not only didn't they expect it, but they had actively written you off.
And wouldn't support it.
But
exactly.
It gives you more fire to succeed.
So when they wouldn't watch my kids, tell them what I did. When you didn't have a baby.
Never saw by herself.
Okay, so we'll hit the stop on that. The
family that brought us over, her daughter was getting, her niece was getting married. So they invited us to go to a wedding.
Separation.
We're like, Separation. Yeah, we're going to an African wedding. So we running around in the marketplace looking for fabric, looking for things and bracelets and wrap our hair and who can we get to sew, and they got tailors in the marketplace. You give them the fabric and 5 hours later you got an outfit, and we buy all this outfit and here we go to the wedding in our African clothes. And we get there and there is this beautiful African woman in this flowing white gown, mm-hmm. and the veil. And they are all of the bridesmaids. This is in Africa. And they're dressed with their flowers. And the guys in their tuxedos. And the parents are dressed like us in African garb. And we get there and the grandmother says, it is so good. It is so good that his first daughter is getting married. And she was able to bring her wedding gown from the JCPenney catalog. It is so good. Everybody's there, they JCPenney clothes. And we done spent all our little naira trying to get African clothes. It is so good.
That's the separation that Damon is talking about, right? So it is day two, and I can't wait to tell you some of the craziness that went down yesterday. As I told you, this is a show about workplace dysfunction fueled by family secrets. And yesterday it became very clear as we walked through this process that some family secrets are going to stay secret. Some families choose to keep their family secret secret. And that's kind of where we are today. Yesterday, there were a series of walkouts. First, the daughter who wrote us walked out on Iyanla. And then her mother walked out on Iyanla. So two times we're sitting in the house while the people who own the house and invited us there are gone, literally leaving us sitting on the couch, leaving Iyanla sitting on the couch. So willingness and readiness are key for this process. If you want to be on Fix My Life, you need to be willing and ready, because it is no joke. It is not a walk in the park. You are doing soul surgery, soul excavation. And if you're not ready for that and not willing to do that with three cameras and 20 people standing in your living room, don't write into the program. I'm just saying. Because what happened yesterday is that we got here, began the process, began the deep digging, and were halted several times because people did not want to take that journey. They just did not want to take that journey. All the things they wrote to us that were issues and challenges that they wanted fixed in their lives, when we got here to fix it, they decided they did not want to take that journey. So what do? We're sitting here, we're asking the questions based upon the information that we have, and we are met with absolute resistance and walkouts. What do? Well, that's what we're figuring out. It's the top of day two. What we do know is that we're not going back to the house where we were walked out on. We're not going back there. So whatever we shoot today, we're going to shoot here at the hotel. And we're going to turn a corner and see where this next chapter will lead. We really don't know. But what we do know is that some families choose to keep their family secrets secret. And frankly, I understand that. To go on national TV and expose all your dirty laundry and blow up your business potentially is not a good thing for most people. People do it every day, for whatever their reasons are, but I totally understand people who choose not to do it. There is a bit of a point of no return for us once we all fly here and set up our equipment and put up the lights and start rolling. But that's a production reality that we will deal with. For people in their hearts, minds, and souls, it really is about willingness and readiness. So I ask myself, because you know I always take it back to me, because that's what's real in my life. Where am I willing and ready to go in my life and in my soul? And where am I unwilling and unready
to travel in my journey? What am I ready and willing to do? And what am I ready and willing not to do, or unready and unwilling to do? Really important to get clear on that. Really, really important to get clear on that. That's food for thought in your quiet time. So I don't know how much time I have before meeting the crew, because we're kind of just playing the schedule out by ear, but I'll show you as much as I can. And it may be that by the time you see this, I may not be able to show you anything, because it just depends on how this all goes down. So if you're watching this and you haven't seen any guests in this video, it's because it got funky donkey. And I had to strip out all the meat so that these family secrets stay secret. So that may be what's happening to the video that you're watching right now. Stay tuned. So it is about 12:38 a.m. and I'm driving home from the airport. I'm about 15, 20 miles from my house, about 15. And this particular shoot in St. Louis was the first of a kind for me, because as I said earlier, our participants decided that they did not want to participate and that they just weren't ready to tell their story. So that's what happened. So you didn't see any of those guests in this video. I shot all the footage, but I'm not sharing it with you, because this is a situation where people gave us a lot of information, and then when we showed up to tell their story, they decided they didn't want to reveal that information. So I'm not even going to show you who they are. And I'm leaving this shoot very clear about a couple of things. One, image. Two, identity. And three, integrity. You are not your image. You are your image, but you're not just your image. You're more than your image. You are more than your identity. What you are is your integrity. And your integrity will help you draw distinctions between your image and your identity. Very important. Three I's: image, integrity, and identity. And I'm leaving this shoot experience very clear that our guests, who you didn't see in this video, are living in the image of who they are, probably not really even knowing or understanding their identity, and really, really, really struggling with their integrity. I'm very clear about that, as I've observed what went down over the last couple of days. So many people just want to be on television. They just want to be on television. And the thought of having cameras around and being seen on television is very seductive for a lot of people. It's even a trap for some people. It was a trap for our guests in this story, because they got sucked in by the allure of the television process, but didn't really want to take the deep dive journey that was being offered them. No judgment, it's fine. I get it. I get why people would not want to take this deep dive. Get it. So for the first time in my experience with Fix My Life, we didn't have a fix. I mean, what is ultimately presented on television is a different story, but what I experienced in reality of actually shooting this story, there was no fix. There was no fix.